Adolescent reproductive health.
Okay, so 63% of teens have sex before they graduate, and only 24 states require sexual education. 1 out of 4 women have an abortion before the age of 45, and only 44% of pregnancies among unmarried women are intended, while only 81% of pregnancies among married women are intended. And here's a chart of the states that do require sex ed.
The background. Sexual education only really began after the 1900s. In 1920, the birth control movement led by Margaret Sanger began, and then by 1960, the modern sexual era had begun. In 1980, only 6 states required sex education, but within the next 9 years, that number had risen to 17 states. In 1996, President Clinton signed a bill that gave block grants to abstinence-only programs, and then in 2010, Obama put in his budget proposal a elimination of abstinence-only programs to replace them with pregnancy prevention programs. But even today, only 24 states require sex education.
Have you ever really been in a scenario where you were with an authority figure and you wanted to have a civil discussion about sex? Not most of the time, that's not the case, because in today's society, there's a taboo surrounding the entire topic of sex and everything that entails. Also, schools have turned to talking about just abstinence or not even anything at all, and that can cause, like, that strange taboo to be even strengthened even more. Now, don't get me wrong about what I'm trying to say. I'm not trying to say that teaching abstinence is not good. It is good, but it should not be the only line of defense against that. So you must have a comprehensive sex education in schools. Also, in other classes, students are required to be inquisitive and asking about things like how does this make this happen? But sex education, we're required to just accept it like at face value.
Along with the social ramifications of this problem comes the ethical boundaries, and the primary concern is finding a comprehensive method of sex education that encompasses students and parents and meets their interests. 89% of parents favored comprehensive sex education, while 11, mostly religious parents, favored abstinence-based sex education. And the ongoing debate being, our schools' main purposes are to provide the best education for the students, while the parents are more invested in the child than the administrator, so who has the greater say in how these children get educated. The Choice Contraceptive Program was founded in St. Louis, and their main aim was to provide affordable and available methods of contraception for teens and its effect on teen pregnancy rates. And by the end of this study, it was found that teen pregnancy rates decreased far below the national rate. And so, that being said, there is a responsibility to teens to provide comprehensive methods of education and efficient access to contraceptives.
Providing sexual education goes beyond just the ethical and social means. The scientific, in the 1980s, teen pregnancies outside of marriage averaged about 46%. By 2002, that number had risen to nearly 80%. Several predisposing factors that have shown to lead to an increase in teen pregnancy rates include an increase in low income rates, lack of parental support, peer pressure, and ignorance regarding contraception. Ninety-five percent of adolescents regularly attend a school, so that makes it a perfect place to implement these kind of programs. Dr. Stan E. Weed found condom usage among adolescents rises from 45.3% to 48.1% following the completion of a sexual education program. 5 out of 6 students began using various forms of contraception, even if it was not previously used. And pregnancy rates decline and the transfer of STDs reduce with consistent and proper condom usage. And that's various forms of contraception around the world, and it shows you different percents and where.
Along with these, there are many economical costs that come along with unintended pregnancies. The cost of having a baby in the U.S. is $4,448. And for a middle-income family to raise a child to the age of 18, it costs $245,000. Also, if the individual does not choose to raise the child, then the cost is transferred over to the government because the child would then be placed in foster care. The average time spent in foster care is 2.6 years, and the average monthly cost for 2,839 children is just over $1 million. According to the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, on average, there are 428,000 children in foster care. There are also prices with abortion. In 1997, the cost of abortion was $310, and in 2001, the cost was $372, which suggests that the prices for abortion will continue to increase over time. Unintended pregnancies result in one of three options: abortion, adoption, or raising the child, all of which the price is greater than that of contraception.
First solution would be to try to eliminate the taboo surrounding sex as a whole. That would allow for a more comfortable atmosphere when trying to talk about sex with anyone, like teachers, parents, or anyone who's older than you who might know more than you might have. Now, the problem within that would be that it's very hard to eradicate a taboo that is that ingrained in our society.
Solution two would be to help the currently pregnant girls who are not yet ready to have a child. And through this, you can inform them about abortion and then give them more education on their options other than just abortion, and give them resources like Planned Parenthood and things to help them with the child.
Our final solution to improve not only the health of adolescents but also the future adults in America would be to provide sexual education programs with content that focuses on more than just abstinence. It should be implemented in all schools, and these programs should include demonstrations on how to use contraception, where to find contraception, information about birth control and how it works, the side effects of hormonal birth control, facts about STDs, and where to find reproductive medical attention.